Now, those are some basic principles. Let's go a little bit deeper into this one called conformity. Conformity. Now, people don't like to think that they're conformists, but we all are. All of us are conformists to some degree. We was talking before here about a movie and my past. I'm a nonconformist. When I was in high school, I didn't look like most people. I had impression management going on. I wore black t-shirts with the names of bands I really liked on them. Torn up jeans before you could actually buy them. I actually worked at the car wash, so when my jeans were torn, it was because I worked in them, not because I purchased them torn already, pre-torn. And hair was long. I'm different than everybody else. And you know who I hung out with? A bunch of people who look just like me. They all had long hair, black t-shirts, and tore up jeans and things like that. We were conforming to a non-conformist subculture, right? So it was interesting. We saw ourselves as radically different, but in some ways we were very much the same and didn't really detect the irony of that until later in life. But if you think about following the crowd, there are some reasons for it. When people agree, they're more likely to be correct or feel correct. Certainly they're more likely to feel correct. A million people being wrong doesn't make it right. And people have had massively wrong notions before and all agreed. Everybody once agreed that the sun went around the earth. Everybody agreeing doesn't make that true. Right? But guess what they all felt? They felt like they were right. Right? And they really resisted other people coming along and saying it might not be so. They even killed people who had the audacity to be so non-conforming as to say it might not be so. And having data to suggest otherwise was dangerous. So when we agree, we feel correct. And we feel weird when we don't agree, especially with people we like. You ever talk to somebody you like and you start ragging on this movie and you're like, oh, it's the worst thing I've ever seen. And then they look at you and you're like, I liked it. And you're like, well, it wasn't that bad. It was all right. I mean, it was pretty good. Well, now, you know, I mean, I'm just saying parts were, you know, for me, parts were problematic, right? Because now I'm out of conformity with somebody I like. It makes me feel weird. I want to feel that unity. And conformity creates unity. We want to be accepted by others, and it works. Conformity works. The entire basis of the fashion industry is conformity. What is a fashion? What's the right thing to wear at any given time? For me, it's anything that keeps you from being arrested and freezing to death. Anything works. Why this? Why not this? Yeah, there was a trend a while back. It's gone now. It's interesting how they come and they go. It starts with a few people, it builds to a lot of people, and then the novelty wears off and it goes away. And the trend was in the summer for girls to wear big fuzzy boots. I think they were called Uggs. Y'all remember that trend? So they'd be wearing a skirt and fuzzy boots. And I'm thinking, as a dude who's got no fashion sense at all, I bet your feet are really sweating a lot. That's got to be, you got to be like sloshing around in them things. But why would you wear fuzzy boots in summer? Because it was the in thing to do. Why was it the in thing to do? Because some group started it, other people adopted it. As more people adopted it, the bandwagon effect is real. It's a real effect, and it can have drastic consequences. There's a reason you're not allowed to yell fire in a crowded theater despite First Amendment rights. Because if you panic one or two people, other people become panicked. If you think about it, if you walk out the door into the street, and let's just say, for argument's sake, we were in a big city, and you saw hundreds and hundreds of people running away from a scene. Me? I'm going to start running. I'm going to run right away. And I'm going to ask as I'm running, what are we running from? Because there's information conveyed in that, right? People doing this indicates something's going on that I don't know about, so it gives me some kind of interpretation of an ambiguous situation. That can be dangerous. It can cause mass panic, but it can also lead to people being saved because the herd behavior sometimes works. Herd mentality is sometimes adaptive, but at other times, it can be tragic. It depends on the circumstances. Ash did this experiment, this social psychology experiment, that most people looking at right off the bat would say, I would never do that. I wouldn't do this. But guess who was in his experiment? A bunch of people, just like the rest of us. And here's what he did. He said, I want you to all judge the lengths of a line. Here's a target line, and I want you to tell me what of the following three stimuli most closely resemble this one. So you had a participant in there who was the actual participant in a range depending on what trial he was doing, but let's just say there were seven others in this case. Seven other people that the participant thinks are participants in the experiment, but they're not. They're acting like it. They're research assistants. And they sit in there and they got it rigged so that the real participant goes last. And you show the target and you say, which of the following lines is closest to the target line? And the first person says, number three. Now you see it's number two, I see it's number two, and the participant sees it's number two, and they probably are thinking to themselves, idiot. Of course, what, how could you possibly reach that conclusion? Right? That's probably what they're thinking. Then the second person says, three. Now, that's weird. Maybe it's the angle they're looking at it. Maybe you start looking at it a little different. The third person says, three. The fourth person says three. And you're probably like, maybe I'm missing something here. Fifth person says three. Sixth person says three. Seventh person says three. What do you say? And 75% of these people at least once would go along with the crowd. They would just say what everybody else said. On looking later, they all thought something was up, but nobody knew what was up. But they felt compelled to do it anyway. 25% would agree almost every time. The number of people opposing it, though, really did have an effect. If there was nobody there opposing it, of course they got it right every time, right? If it was just one or two other people, they would conform sometimes when it was wrong, but not as often. But the more people you had up to a point, it only took five to reach this asymptotic level. And you see, the more you get, it starts to look ridiculous and drops a little bit. But the pressure is right here. Peer pressure, peers being our people, is real. Doesn't mean people automatically do stuff they don't want to do. But there's a subtle social pressure being exerted on people. Now, you might look at that and say, well, that's interesting, but who gives a damn? Right? That's good critical thinking skills. You should always ask, why should I care? I'm now on jury duty. Guess what happens in juries? Everybody has to come to agreement. Guess what happens in trials? You get presented with evidence as a jury that is sometimes ambiguous. And you have one lawyer saying you should interpret it this way, and you have another lawyer saying you should interpret it that way. Oftentimes diametrically opposed from one another. And then you retire to deliberate. And in deliberating, you have to reach a conclusion. Now, if you've had psychology as a science, you'll know some things that a lot of people don't know. You'll know that eyewitness testimony, pretty shaky at best, all right? You'll know what we talk about here shortly. Groupthink processes and conformity actually conspire to make people agree when they don't agree. There's a pressure to go with the crowd that's so powerful that people oftentimes bow to that pressure. And you hear them in jury interviews after the verdicts have been delivered. Occasionally you'll get ones like, I really didn't think that, but everybody else seemed to think it, so I just went along with it. That's powerful when you consider people's lives, right? Victims want justice, but innocent people shouldn't be convicted of things they didn't do. And a lot of times it's far more ambiguous than we care to admit, but when you get a couple strong personalities in a jury room who think something for sure, and they convince a couple other people to swing that way, it's not long before oftentimes many people will just go along. And there's pressure. Heard a story of a woman arguing in a jury where one person was the holdout. And her kid had a birthday party that night. And by God, if you make me miss this birthday party, seriously, I don't get to leave until you agree with everybody. All of us have to stay here until you agree. Think about the pressure. But then you do have some people. Keep in mind, we're looking at personality in the last chapter. And now we're looking at social situations making us behave in ways that we never would have predicted. But you do have a quarter of people who never went along, right? Entrenched. I ain't going along. It's not what I do. It's interesting because people will go along some of the time, and the more pressure there is, the more likely they are to go along. So one Confederate who dissented was all it took for people not to go along. That's the devil's advocate. There's a reason you should play the devil's advocate in groups. Because when groups get together, the pressure is to agree for all the reasons we talked about and some more we're going to talk about. In other words, reason sometimes goes out the window in favor of group harmony. But sometimes you need to be that one person who's like, I'm not sure about that. Let's talk about it. If you're strong in that position and you're right, you may swing other people to your view. But sometimes you can't even do it with the best of evidence. People just don't do it. So overall, about 37% of the time, people would go along with whatever was said by the group. That's powerful. It's real. Happens in our everyday lives, but we don't appreciate it. Nonconformity. Who the hell dresses up on Friday? Nonconformists dress up on Friday. This is me at my pre-doctoral internship. This is the first day of internship. You got to go through pre-doctoral internship to get your doctorate. Can't get your PhD unless you do this. First day shows up, these people from all over the country. I show up looking like this. They show up looking like that. Chilling, happy to be here, moving to a new town. And they're already bonding. Look at me, I'm kind of off over here. Yeah, I'm with them. Kinda. It's hot out there, actually. I'm sweating at that point. But I'm committed to the look, right? I'm self-monitoring and all that other stuff. And these are my friends. I love them. They're great people. Just met them at the time, though, that moment. But sooner or later, I got them to come around to my way of thinking. I got them to get straight in their heads, right? You can't go around dressing like that. You got to dress like this. Nah, that was my birthday. I didn't know they were going to do that. Because guess who showed up every single day looking like this shit, right? Hey, one day I walk in, everybody's dressed like that. That's kind of nice, though. You think about it. They liked me enough to kid me on my birthday, and I liked him enough to take that and not tell them. You know what? You're onto something there. I think you should all look just like that all the time.